I didn't want to do this episode, but you might have to check the temps on this one.
Killing all my brothers in the street. Then you drive home to your family. Oh, you sleep when you left for next family. You weep. Move beyond justice. Is there such thing? Cause every time we see the judge, we never win. So don't you judge me by the color of my skin, you know. We got a dream like Martin Luther. That's the key, you know. Believe it, you
I'm gonna do the intro now because I'm trying to get to the shit. Team Vision, Fuck Your Help Podcast. And who am I with?
Aay Jay.
Yeah.
The Oasis Podcast.
Because when this song is over, we're gonna get straight to the shits. You with it?
I'm with it.
This is my Purge episode, so we're going straight to it for me.
I'm with it. That's why I'm smitten, try and get it any way I'm living. Patriotism ain't beneficial. Wave your pistol and to somebody listen. It's where the ghetto, they see the struggle, market the image. It's where they swear to shoot everything with build up aggression. Bald eagle and desert eagle, you pick a preference. Cause they pick out weapons and bop, bop, bop. It's your pick your friends. This is so for my hope. That I am giving you hope. They're mine, they're mine. Yeah, we just sold this mic. There's no note, you might. Hey, blame that on Obama to my future son and daughter. Why use this marijuana? Try Google and Eric Garner and tell me it's over there. You've been who can just get them out there when the youth is out there is only contributing to problems. Nobody is releasing senseless shot in your head. I make your body drop lifeless. In my town, my town. I don't take a 911 cause the Babylon don't give a fuck about the black man. In my town, my town, Obian. As my therapist says, time to get to the shits. I'ma just toss my phone on that one. That was My Town by Wale. Y'all, this is the Fuck Your Help Podcast. And as much as I want to be animated today, y'all might get an animated me, but not like the last episode, for real. So, this is the Fuck Your Help Podcast, and we're doing a special collab with a good friend of mine, Ms. Aay Jay, y'all. Welcome her back. Hey, y'all.
And I'm going to welcome myself back to the Oasis Podcast, y'all. I know y'all used to hearing me a little bit more articulate, but... Guess what? This is my podcast now. We talk shit. And it's okay because I like an eloquent audience too. Because, you know, what did 2 Chainz say? What did 2 Chainz say? Pretty girls love trap music? That's what we had. Pretty girls love fuck niggas in backpacks.
Oh.
And this is that. Ooh, this is that podcast for that. The fuck niggas in park. You know, fuck niggas. See, that's how you know I'm off. It's for fuck niggas in backpackers. So yeah, y'all heard the song, so y'all know what we're about. So let's just get to the shits. Aay Jay. I'm 33?
No, nigga.
Nah, nigga. I'm 32 and what? 3 months? 32 and 9 months?
Why you always making yourself older, fam?
We needed a comedy moment, right? But yeah, I'm... Bruh. Before we start, mental health check-in, right?
Mm, that's important.
It's important, right? I'm going to put that honor on you for going first.
Honestly, I've been checking in on people, asking them how they've been, and I literally, when I'm asked the same question, I don't have an answer. I don't know how I feel, honestly.
You know... it took me talking to my mom about this, but not related. You know what I mean? Like, we just watching the news, kicking it. And, this white's killing us. White's killing blacks, and cops killing blacks. Kind of put me in a place where, like, I'm contemplating the man who I want to become, and understanding what my responsibilities as a black male. And these three feelings kind of put it into perspective for me. I'm scared.
Mm.
I'm tired.
Mm.
And I'm angry.
Mm.
So this is my first Purge podcast for the Fuck Your Help listeners. So y'all get used to me being a little bit more introspective and talking a little bit more about what I'm feeling and going through on this one. And I'm hoping that Miss Aay Jay's listeners could value that. And as well as my listeners.
I think they will, for sure.
So we're going to start off with me being scared. Y'all, I'm 6'5". AJ's looking at me crazy. She's like, nigga, you're not 6'5". There you go again. I'm 6'4" and change.
6'4". Y'all niggas love lying about y'all height.
And our age, right? I'm 6'4" and change, right, y'all? I'm not going to lie about my weight. I'm a little over $2. Black man dreads. Yo, I don't know how to maneuver on these streets. Background story, y'all, I'm from East New York. And this is not something new. I've been harassed by cops before. I learned how to maneuver around the cops when it was just getting stopped. I knew how to maneuver around the streets with the homies out there. I was already worried about the homies out there that's struggling trying to get their shit together. And I'm always worried about the cops. But not like the last 10 years. Like, we always seen cops killing niggas.
Mm-hmm.
But the last 10 years, it's just been, it's just a constant for me. Just to see it just on and on and on again. And it just makes me, like, not know how to maneuver out here. I don't know who to trust.
Mm.
Yeah, so that's where I'm kind of at as far as the scared part. Like, I don't know who to trust. I can't trust the homies out there. Hmm. We know what it's like, you know, crabs in a barrel mentality out there.
Mm-hmm.
You got to walk around. You got to worry about what you're wearing, what you look like, what girl you talk to, what block they hustling on. And you already had to worry about that with the police, but now you got to worry about white women who don't want to put their dogs on leashes.
Hmm.
Now you got to worry about being stereotyped and people believing because you're black, you're giving counterfeit money.
Mm.
And now you're getting choked by the police.
$20.
$20. This is the everyday thing, y'all. This is everyday shit. And I don't know how to maneuver around that now. You know what I mean? So, I mean, AJ, I don't know how you feel about that, but it's hard out from, like, especially with, like, we got this asshole as president. Like, just some back trauma, y'all. Like, I think I got some racism PTSD. Like, I've been stopped by police and whatever. But, like, I was in Charlottesville for those riots. I've seen them shits. I was there. Like, I've seen racist Klansmen and neo-Nazis fuck up black people for the sake of a statue.
Hmm.
And I left the South and came back to New York. So, I mean, knowing that black people were getting killed. But, like, damn. Like, I can't even be regular no more. So, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know. This shit is scary, man. I can't go down South. Can't be up North. Like, where do you go? What do you do? Do I stay locked up in my room? I don't know.
Yeah. It's absolutely fucking terrifying. On so many fucking levels. I remember, it's just so many levels to this, but I remember after Sandra Bland happened, I was driving down Flatbush Avenue about to turn up on Parkside, and cops was behind me, and I was frozen in fear. I almost started crying. Like, that's how scared I was. Because we were seeing the deaths happen, right? We saw Trayvon. We saw just so much, so much.
Eric.
Oh, my gosh. So much. And just the mere fact that they pulled up behind me, my mind went to, I could probably not make it home. Mm-mm. And it's not nothing new growing up in the hood, right? It's not nothing new seeing cops hella disrespectful, fucking niggas up. But at the same time, in some regards, their presence is needed, right? Mm-hmm. For safety. You know what I'm saying? And so it's not completely fuck them completely, but fuck the ones who are out here with the bullshit, right? Mm-hmm. But this just level of fear that I think is so unnecessary, literally for doing nothing. I know I ain't do shit. I did absolutely fucking nothing, but that's not, that doesn't mean anything, right? That doesn't mean that if they take you in, you ain't gonna be done for. Mm-hmm. And I remember being terrified. And I remember after that time period, that sat with me for a while, and then I was able to kind of unpack it, I think, with my colleagues. And after that, I decided to reclaim that. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I was like, nah, I'm not gonna ever be afraid in that way again. Like, because to me, it wasn't logical. You know what I mean? It was pure emotional, for sure. But for me as a Black woman, for me as a lover of Black people, we can't live in a state of fear, because that's gonna immobilize us.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Can we hold that topic of fear?
Of course.
I mean, that specific thought, because it brought me into something that I wanted to talk about, so I want to, like, bring that back. How fear can escalate into anger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you know people who are officers?
Do I know officers? Yeah.
So this is touchy for me, because I know quite a couple of officers, mm-hmm. Black, Asian, Latino, white. And it goes back to not knowing who to trust.
Mm-hmm.
I have a cousin who's an officer, a great guy. Like, I have mentors who are officers. But then I know that one bad apple doesn't mm-hmm. mean you throw away the bunch.
Right.
But I'm looking, and I have to think, like, what happens if I'm the one walking down the street, and for y'all who know me, y'all know Vision takes these long ass walks. He does his puff puff past himself. So what happens if I'm walking out there, I'm doing that, and a car pulls behind me, and it's my boy and his partner. It's my cousin and his partner. Do I trust them?
Hmm.
Are they gonna throw me to the floor? Is my boy is one of the people that could potentially kill me, because hmm. that blue shield, like they stand behind that blue shield, that blue wall.
Hmm.
And that shit is fucking terrifying. Super terrifying. So I don't know if that relates to you, but I just find that part hard. And then, like, then with knowing that there's officers that look like us, what do we tell the kids
mm-hmm.
in the community that's mm-hmm. like, you know, like, my mom raised me, be careful around white cops.
Mm.
Be careful around these Asian cops.
But it's
it's us too. What's that, Officer Garcia? Fuck you, Officer Garcia, for real, for real. Yeah. But like what? Like, it's us doing it too.
It's that, because it's once you apart, and that's the thing. I agree with you. I know people I grew up with who are cops, and it's easy to be like, well, everyone's not like that. Okay, that's true. We can't throw everybody in the same basket. The thing is, though, is that the NYPD, or just police office, police departments in any state in the U.S. are part of a gang.
Mm-hmm.
They are the biggest gang in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens when you in a gang? You can have a good heart, but while you with your crew, what do you do?
Mm-hmm.
What the fuck the crew want to do?
Facts.
Right? And that's the part that's scary, because that person can be thinking in that moment, damn, this shit is fucked up. I shouldn't, but will they stop? I have yet to see mm-hmm. a video or experience, because I've been in a car with partners being pulled over and the shit happening, and one cop is hella disrespectful, and the other just stands there. They never check them. Mm-hmm. They never check them. And I haven't seen a video yet when a cop is doing some bullshit and the other cop is like, let me pull him over to the side.
Did you see that video where, I think it was in Minnesota, where a black woman was talking to an officer and she was talking to the officer and the officer is like, she's right, and he starts crying. Mm-mm. So this woman is talking to the officer and like about what? During the protest about what's going on. Oh,
okay.
And he starts tearing as he's standing in formation. And his orders were if they move forward to attack. And this was miraculously caught on camera. Mm. But she's talking to him and this guy starts crying. Mm. And she's like, you know it's right. Like, you know we're right. Like, take a knee. Take a knee with us. And she goes down and take a knee and she's like talking. Mm-hmm. And you can see him like waving back. Like, his body is literally rocking mm-hmm. back and forth because he knows it's right. And he's crying. He's trying to hold it in. And then I guess a supervisor or something saw him, and then the supervisor moved him out, and then the supervisor jumps in the line and stands tall with a big-ass baton, just waiting. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, what you just said just...
No, it's cool. This is event and such. Speak your mind, black man. I know black men are not the only people being killed out here. We already know this, right? Because Breonna Taylor that just passed away? Mm-hmm. That got shot up.
Was it a white person?
It happened. No, she's black. Cops shot up. Wow. That happened in March, though. And it's now we're hearing about it because the whole coronavirus shit. Mm. So we out here. And when I say we, men, women, we're out here dying. And the fact of the matter is too many people getting upset. Because I had my homeboy. He was on social media going back and forth. And I don't play those back and forth games. I don't play back and forth games. Because people, let them sit in their ignorance. That's their business. But he was, you know, going back and forth with particular people. And I'm protective. And so I went on there like, nah, y'all not doing this with my homie, right? But the fact is, he really said something. What he said was pretty logical. It was, you guys get so mad when we are going against all cops because it's because cops are the bad cops are the ones who are doing the fucked up shit. Mm-hmm. But where are the good cops speaking up? That's all he said. Mm-hmm. He was like, where are the good cops to speak up? Why y'all not checking each other? Why when things like this happen, y'all not speaking up saying, hey, nah, this ain't right. We ain't all about this. We want this person to be reprimanded according to the crime, blah, blah, blah. But it doesn't happen.
You know, I can't look. This is something that's old in America, right? But we look at the black community and we look at the trauma that goes on with the black-on-black violence. And we wonder why the police can't be active in the hood. Mm. This is the people we're supposed to trust. If I got my brother trying to rob me, and now I gotta worry about, okay, my brother tried to rob me, I call the police, both of us might die. Both of us don't die.
It's a fact.
I can't look at police, like, I can't look at a good cop now, because they have that shield that they stand behind, that blue wall they call. Like, there's no such thing. If you are willing to get in a cop car with a partner who is a known racist, who's a known murderer of people of color, then
who just don't regard or respect people of color, period.
Then you are worse than him.
Huh.
And that goes for black to me. That goes for white. Hmm.
Latino, Asian. It don't matter. All of them.
Rest in peace, Akil Gurley, too, a brother from East New York, Pink Houses, who was leaving the building.
Oh, I don't remember.
And the door slammed.
Yeah.
And the Asian cop blasted him.
Yeah, I remember.
Shout out to you and your family, man.
It's too many. Facts. It's too fucking many, man.
Let's jump into a track that's cool with you, Aay Jay.
Yeah.
This is gonna be another one of those songs, though. Part of that song is so important, though, because, like, it encourages the police to do what they want to do. We encourage that shit, y'all. Pay attention.
We left at a crossroads. Something fucked up is going on. We want a person to get help. We literally got to sit there and pause and think, do I really want to call the cops?
Exactly.
Because, one, not only can the person who's doing the harm get fucked up, but then the people who haven't done anything can get fucked up. And so what the fuck do you do?
That's another podcast, y'all know, y'all. We're gonna talk about that shit, organizing. Mm-hmm. I got a guest for that. That's one out of three black men, they said. One out of three black men in jail. Are women not respected? This is the type of America we living in, y'all. We live in a fucking police state.
No more political monsters, no more secret space launches. Government department started it in the projects. Material objects, thousands up in the closets. Could have been invested in the future for my comrades. Battle contacts, primitive weapons out in combat. Many never come back, pretty niggas be running with gas. Rather get shot in they back than fire back. We tired of that, corporations hiring blacks. Denying the facts, exploiting us all over the map. That's why I write the shit I write in my raps. It's documented, I meant it. Every day of the week, I live in it, breathe in it. It's more than just fucking believe in it. I'm holding in ones, rolling up my sleeves and shit. It's C-Lo for push-ups now. Many headed for one conclusion. Niggas ain't ready for revolution. Yeah, it's blackmail. Live a third of his life in a jail cell. Cause the world is controlled by the white male. And the people don't never get justice. And the women don't never get respected. And the problems don't never get solved. And the jobs don't never pay enough. So the rent always be late. Can you relate?
Police State by Dead Prez. The next part for me, Miss Aay Jay, and I'm gonna be like real honest.
Mm-hmm.
I'm tired.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a few things, cause like this shit ain't new, so you know what I mean. But there's some adding on shit, especially right now. I'm dealing with my own shit, my own personal shit, and it's draining the fuck out of me. It is so tiresome. And I'm doing all this self-reflection and self-growth and career shit in the midst of coronavirus. Just stressing about work. And I just laid off employees. They're just now finding out an idea what's going to happen to us full-time staff. And we're not sure. I got all this shit. Goals I want to do. Family shit that I'm dealing with. And I got all this baggage, and this is adding on, this baggage, this situation, this shit is adding on while I'm grieving through my own shit. And it's been affecting me a lot, to be quite frank. Especially my confidence. And to be honest with y'all, I'm really tired of the constant reminders that society doesn't value me. Us black folk, we have a very interesting dynamic, right? because we all struggle with, and I say all black people in America struggle with understanding like self-value. And with that, struggling with that, in the black community, we also struggle with the value in the black community. So black men feel like black women don't value.
And black women feel like black men.
Exactly, I was about to say that. And yep. then to go outside and have to deal with the rest of the
world. The world don't fucking value
just,
you.
It's just like everything is on your shoulder and on your back. And it's really fucking up my confidence and the things that I feel like is going to be important for me to perform in the future. And it's tiresome. This whole thought process is tiresome for me. Especially with now I'm pinpointing the man I want to be. And I have to think about things like, I got two godchildren. I have a niece and a nephew. They're all black. That's it. And I got to be a uncle, a godparent to them. In the future, I'm going to be a dad. I just don't know with this constant reminders of like my value to society. I just don't know if my kids will ever feel that value. And it makes me kind of feel like there's no hope. Because it's just constant, you know, constant
struggle.
Like I'm tired of the deal with the constant struggle, the constant reminders, the things that we gotta go through this, and it's just tough because, like, the last time I felt like this was with Nip, when we was recording your podcast,
when Nip
died, it was like, yo, what the fuck, like I had to think about this, and the time before that it was with Trayvon and Eric. And I remember with Sean Bell getting in an argument with one of my bosses. It's like, I'm tired. Not, like, I know it's something that's constant, so I'm numb to hearing these stories, if that makes sense. Meaning numb as, like, my reaction was numb at some point. But, I'm drained, bro. It's draining because these things introduce so many thoughts, and it makes me wonder, like, yeah. What kind of thoughts you was?
No, to be black in this society is to be in a constant state of fatigue and in a perpetual state of tiredness. And by tired, meaning just like what you said, being drained, but it's physical, it's emotional, it's mental, it's financial, it's spiritual. Because the fact of the matter is... you know, depending on how you're raised or whatever, it was always this constant. If you appear to be different, dress different, right? Carry yourself different. Educate yourself. Like, you're going to then be viewed different and valued, and it doesn't make a fucking difference. And not only is that process, while you're going through it, draining, because you constantly have to prove that you know better and are better. And even if you're 1,000 times smarter than these motherfuckers in the workplace or at school, you got to work 10 times harder when they could be as dumb as a motherfucking rock, and yet they still get to progress, right? And then once you out of those spaces, right, at work or school, and you're just outliving your daily life, your mere existence, your mere fact that you're breathing, it causes fear. Mm-hmm. And that shit is exhausting because it doesn't matter how you carry yourself. You're 6'4 with locks, right? But you have a baby face, right? Mm-hmm. I, of course, I'm a black woman. I see you. I don't look at you and see you as a threat. But some random ass white bitch can feel that way. And don't get it twisted. I have quote unquote white friends, but they understand. They're the type of white friends to understand their motherfucking privilege. And they also understand my plight. And so they know when I speak, I'm going to speak the truth regardless.
Mm-hmm.
But me being a black woman, was a little bit who's quote unquote medium toned or whatever they want to view me. Mm-hmm. I got locks. I walk with confidence. I carry myself in a particular way.
Confidence
and yet,
is a threat.
Correct. When we're in workspaces, guess what I'm deemed, right? I'm angry or I'm too aggressive or whatever I said needs to be fact checked or there needs to be more evidence behind. Like, but yeah, you hired me for this job for my credentials and my knowledge. But yet, when we in this table coming up with ideas and to strategize, oh, shit needs to be double checked. You know what I mean? And that shit is exhausting. And to go through this every day in and day out, you then start to live in a space of exhaustion. What that means is you go to work and you're like, fuck it, I don't even give a fuck no more, right? You're maneuvering the world on some fuck it shit, and that's what they want. They want you to be in this state of fatigue. They want you to be tired, right? When you're thinking about war, what's a tactic that's usually used, right? You hit people one either when they're asleep, or you keep going at them until they're fatigued, right? Because what happens? You're once you are in that state, you not only you can have the want to fight, but then you physically cannot, right? And that's the problem. And it's just like we're constantly having to tread this thin ass motherfucking line of keep moving and just keep pushing and hope for the best. Or become this ball of anger that's only going to freaking to just diminish our beings and bring us to our early grave if they don't do it, you know, because of the stress and shit that we deal with, and it's fucking exhausting. It's sad that the mere fact that just because we are here, our mere existence strikes so much fear, right? Because that's what it boils down to. They're fucking afraid. And I think at this point, we need to give some shit to be the fucking afraid of. That's just how I feel.
You touched on the next part of what I want to talk about, which is what happens when that combination of fear and fatigue happens, and where the community is now and where we are. We're just gonna jump to the song because this next part I think is gonna be loaded. So I'm gonna play a song. It relates because this song is literally about an illness that came out of nowhere and the trauma, the things that how this illness like fucked up the world. So this is Streets on Fire by Lupe Fiasco. So what's gonna happen is, right, this next part, I'm a purge. I'm gonna get this shit all out. And we're gonna try to get Miss Aay Jay, the therapist, the space and time to purge.
Not a therapist.
to purge and, you know, let it all out. And allow her to take control of the podcast from the end of my part.
What?
Yes.
Just allocating work to me?
This is a collab.
I thought it was a freestyle section.
I was going to say N-word, this is a collab, but then I was like, oh, can't say the N-word on this one.
Quarantine, the dreams, the survival connection. Don't let them in, not a friend, not a reflection. Every
Everybody's got it and want you to have it next to you. Don't accept them if you want to stay as an exception. Appeal can heal. Some are still in doubt of his existence. Some call it forgiveness and some call it the vengeance. Some say it's an exit and some say it's an entrance. The poor say the rich have the cure. The rich say the poor are the source. Revolutionary say a psychological war invented by the press just to have something to report. Some say the first case came from a maternity ward. Some say you're more. Some say the skies. Some say the floors. Poor say the nuns. None say the whores. And everybody is sure. The scientists say it only affects the mind. The little boy said it only affects the girls. The preacher man said it's gonna kill off the soul. A bum said it's gonna kill the whole wide world. Death is on the tip of her tongue and danger's at the tip of her finger. Streets are on fire tonight. Death is on the tip of her tongue and danger's at the tip of her finger. Streets are on fire. Signs by the loudspeakers repeating that everything is fine. A subtle silence to demolish the troubled conscience of accomplice with no knowledge and every freedom denied. Every dream is designed and broadcasted from the masses to the masses, from the antennas on top of the shrines. Respond and receive and plan during the panic and shorting. It reports back everything in your mind. Everything is lying. Everything is gone. Everything is a rule. Everything is a crime. Everything was here, then everything rewind. A new weather burning feathers off everything shine. She loves it. The sadness, the madness, the bad shit, the lavish, the fastness, the clashes, the ashes, everything intertwined. My femme fatale, my darling fraudulent angel. Once caught a change in the batteries in a halo. Receipt for wings and everything that she paid for. And the address to the factory where they made those. The scientist said she's on the side of mine. The little boy said what happened to all the girls. The preacher man said she's gonna kill off her soul. The dope boy said it's the whole wide world.
Yo, we gonna jump to the next shit immediately because this next song is exactly how I'm feeling. This is where I need the gunshots. Listen to this song.
Until the philosophy which old one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned.
Shout out to Georgia, Richmond, Minneapolis, Detroit, DC, Baltimore, Philly, the 757, New York, Providence, Boston, New Haven, Chicago, Miami, Dallas, Austin, Houston, Los Angeles.
That until the basic human rights are equally guaranteed
to
all without regard to race, and it's a war. That until that day,
the Carolinas,
the dream of lasting
Mississippi, Louisiana. St. Louis.
Will remain in but a fleeting illusion to be pursued but never attained. Now everywhere is war. War. And until the ignoble and unhappy regime that hold our brothers in Angola, in Mozambique, South Africa, subhuman bondage, have been toppled, totally destroyed. Well, everywhere is war. It's a war. War in the east. War in the west. War up north, war down south, war, war, rumors of a war.
The last part for me, y'all, is I'm angry. Miss Aay Jay channeled that so well. Let's talk about my temperament for the police right now. On my way here, I took a stop at Prospect Park. And those of y'all that know Brooklyn and protests and, you know, Flatbush. Mm-hmm. It's been a hotbed for protesting. We love y'all out here, yeah. Flatbush. And I never was a type to make eye contact with police. I was taught not to. I was taught, like, if you know you're doing something wrong, hide that shit around police. And I say that to all to say, like, at some point when you're tired,
you stop giving a
fuck. You're afraid. You stop caring. And it, to be quite frank, y'all, like I remember my godfather asking me once, like, are you willing to die for this being black shit? And my immediate thought was, of course, like, if it's for the sake of protecting somebody else, like, protecting my, like, if I had children or nieces and nephews or whatever, I didn't think about it, like, in the deeper scheme. But in reality, it's like, if I'm, like Ms. AJ said before, like, if I'm doing right or if I'm doing wrong, mm-hmm. the chances are that I might go. Different. And I'm at the point that I don't know if I can respond to police without hostility. And I think I might be at the point that if a police confronts me, a police officer confront me, we might have to do what it do. And it's not to, like, pretend to be, like, some street nigga or some shit, but, mm. like, I'm kind of at the point, like, I don't give a fuck. Because either way, I'm dying.
Mm.
And that's a tough thing to look, to think about. Like, to be, like, any way, I gotta go.
Mm.
Either way, I'm going to jail for something. Y'all gonna fuck me up and kill me. Or I'm gonna fight back and get the chance to run, which most likely probably mean y'all gonna shoot my ass. And I know that's a tough thing to say, but, like, I had no more fear for them. And it sucks because I know some really great people who are officers, but, you know, at this point in my life, it's like, fuck the police. If I see another black man getting attacked by the police, I'm more inclined now to help. And I remember that Justin Bieber song he made where he got caught. He's like, just another nigger. Mm-mm. That, like, that's what I feel. That's the case, and it is. It's just another dead nigger, and it's just another dead nigger. And that's all across the spectrum now. I've come to realize, like, yo, like, I'm going to die being pro-black, and I'm going to die protecting my black family. So it is what it is. And it's such a sad place to realize in some ways, because it's like, look what it takes. Look what had to happen for you to be comfortable. Like, the fact that I'm comfortable with death by police brutality. And I'm uncomfortable with that because of anger. I don't know if I'm still willing to cooperate with police. In fact, in that first song that we played from Wale, he has a line that really, like, hit when he said this. Bald eagle or desert eagle, you pick your preference. And it was like what? As this podcast is going, y'all hear the back.
Mm-hmm.
And the police is down the block.
Yeah, the hood is hot.
And back to the Wale reference, it was just like, bald eagle or desert eagle, you pick your friend. Like, because, like, at this point, I can't be American, so I can't follow that bald eagle. So I got to do what I got to do to protect myself. And he uses the desert eagle, but it's like, you got the fact that you got to pick your identity in America as, like, somebody who's, I mean, AJ, I know you were born in the States?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Somebody who's born in the States, I am American. And it's not even like I'm American via another country, could that be understandable? But, like, my ancestors were brought to America in the 1400s. The fuck? I really got to pick between being black or being American. Hmm. When my, like, it's built on the backs of blacks. And now you're telling me I got to pick. Hmm. And regardless of what I pick, y'all niggas don't give a fuck.
Facts.
Like, people don't give a fuck. Like, I've walked up and down the neighbors, and I've been seeing white people out. Everybody got their BLM shirts on and shit. Like, it's all right, cool. Well, I mean, they got to play that part because they gentrified a hood, but that's another story. Huh. But, like, y'all niggas still don't give a fuck. Mm. Because then y'all calling Karens and all them shits. Huh. Y'all live in our neighborhoods. Y'all, like, America don't give a fuck. Mm. Even if I say I'm American, you know what I mean? Sellouts, like, you know what I mean? Uncle Tom niggas, I promise you all the Uncle Tom niggas on my timeline.
Ooh, child.
Y'all
got a rude
awakening when the police pull up on y'all niggas. Mm. And this shit is anger. Anger, it drives anger. Mm. I know to the fans, like, what I'm saying is just, like, all over the place. But it's coming from a feeling of feeling defeated. Hmm. Y'all, it's come from a place where, like, my trust for the police is already gone. Been gone. This is not one of the things I think, like, I know what to do. Or, like, there's no solution, to be real. Like, I you fire the police head, it doesn't matter. Like, this is something that's embedded in the DNA of this country. And it's kind of like, well, what do you do? Like, you live in it, you shut up and deal, you fight back. I'm kind of at the fight back phase.
So, as you're speaking, this is coming to me, something that I read recently that speaks to what's wrong with America currently, right? We're dealing with the coronavirus and the virus of racism all at the same fucking time. And as being someone with a public health background, when it comes to viruses, a lot of times you can't just take a drug and it makes the virus go away. So what you have to do is either you find a vaccine for it, right? Or the body has to purge itself of it. And this is what the fuck is going on.
The purge.
We are purging ourselves of the bullshit. But the thing with viruses, and if we're looking at racism as a virus, is to understand that viruses never go away. You understand? But we want the body to get healthy enough that if it is dormant, it stays that way. Or if it's reintroduced to you, it has no effect on you. And I think that's how we really need to think about this. The anger can't die, right? There's nothing wrong with being angry. It's how we apply that anger, I think, is important. But black people, people of color, you need to be fucking angry. You can't sit here and just be like, well, it's not going to change. So what the fuck that mean? So you cool with it? You cool with your kids dealing with this shit? You cool with the possibility of knowing your fucking kids, your nephews, your cousins, your husband, your brother, your sisters, your aunties, your mother, your nieces can possibly go outside and never fucking return home? And it's not on some freak accident shit, not on some car accident. Not on some regular shit. It's because some fucking person saw them and looked at them and was like, nah, your existence means nothing to me. And I'm tired of hearing the fucking narrative from people of color as well. Because my friend showed me some screenshot for some bullshit somebody he was following saying, oh, black people kill black people all the fucking time. If y'all dumb motherfuckers keep sharing this motherfucking narrative, let me tell y'all something. People of any race, if you want to use that terminology. But the fact of the matter is, more than likely, people of the same race are around people of the same race, right? Socially, right? They're around people of the same race. So therefore, if they're in the communities with these people, what happens in communities? Everything happens in communities, right? So violence is going to happen among those people. White people kill white people too. Why is that never fucking brought up? But it's always, well, black people kill black people. Guess what? White people kill white people too. They killing their girlfriends. They robbing banks. They killing their husbands. They doing all that same shit. You want to know why? Because they're usually around white people. Now, here's the difference, you dumb motherfuckers. Because that shit made me hot when I seen it. People who think like this. Here's the difference. How often do you hear black people killing white people? And now think about how often you hear white people killing super black people.
Fat. Super fat.
Now that is why it's a motherfucking problem. And now in the instances you're going to pull up one or two people who actually kill white people. Now let's think about that. How often are they convicted and go to jail compared to when the white folk kill a black person? Sometimes they don't even get arrested, let alone fucking convicted and go to jail. So that bullshit narrative that people is pushing, that shit is fucking dumb. And the fact that it's coming out of people of color's mouths, y'all are fucking idiots. The fact of the matter, in any community where you're surrounded by people who look like you, shit is gonna go the fuck down. Positive and negative. There's gonna be people in the community that help people with their groceries. And there's gonna be people who slinging drugs and don't give a fuck. Because that's what communities are made of. Period. It doesn't matter what you're consisted of and look like. But what is important here is the fact that when lives are taken from someone other, the justice system slams the fucking hammer down harder mm-hmm. when the person is of color. Mm-hmm. Period. And that shit is angering. And people need to be angry. People need to be angry. And that anger can't subside. It cannot subside. And you know what that anger is? The anger is the body that is us people of color fighting the motherfucking virus. Mm-hmm. It's setting up shop to let you, the virus, know we ain't with the shits and you not infecting us no more. You ain't coming for us no more. You can try, but we got our defenses up. And that is what needs to be heard and understood, that anger is good. At this point, it is good. But of course, being a person of the mental health field, I need to also stress, and as Vision put it, a self-care guru, I would like to say, a connoisseur, we also need to also take care of ourselves. We got to be cognizant of how we are not only treating others, but ourselves. Because if you allow them to beat you down mentally with the stress of their bullshit, or even taking on the fact that nothing's going to happen, I might as well just take it. You in yourself are diminishing your life's capacity. So you need to take care of yourself. Make sure you're keeping the body strong. You make sure you're keeping the mind strong. Make sure we lean on each other. Because that's the only way we're going to get through this. There's too much fucking division. In the white fucking community, how often, outside of the Me Too movement, on some real shit, how often do you see they publicly shame each other? How often do you see that they really go at each other's necks? But black people do it all the time and think that shit is fucking okay. If I do something wrong and we in front of company meaning the white folk, pull me to the side and correct me. Don't do it in front of these motherfuckers. Mm-hmm. Period. Because right there, they're going to play off of that division. Stop with the bullshit. We're never going to get further if we don't stop with the bullshit. Right now, not to say I'm not someone that's going to be like, yeah, I promote violence. But at the same time, I was born in the hood. I'm fucking of Haitian ancestry. So you know how we get down.
Yo, violence begets violence.
Facts. They taught us violence. And that's the thing. I forget the sister's name, but she gave that speech that touched my spirit. When she was talking about the looting, the rioting, and all that shit. Y'all niggas taught us that shit.
Boston Tea Party.
Y'all made that shit. And now y'all mad when others are using it. But when y'all niggas do it, it's all good. Fuck out of here. And the fact of the matter is, in America, it's about the bottom line. It's about the money. Fuck up the money. That's when they care. Because stores generate money, right?
They worry about Target.
Correct. Target put out a statement talking about they was good. No, you know what? Yo, they got insurance.
You want to know some crazy shit I saw? I saw a black
person. And people so worried about that shit.
I saw a black person say that we shouldn't destroy Target because Target brings jobs to the hood.
Let me tell y'all. And this is why we're going to stay exactly where we are.
And it's once again, these Uncle Ruckus motherfuckers, right? Because if y'all know Brooklyn, y'all know gentrification is a bitch. And you know the, one of the first signs of gentrification in your neighborhood when things change, when the supermarkets go and the Targets and the Walmarts come up, when the bodegas can't sell coffee and the Starbucks come up, they taking jobs from us. They taking our ability to create jobs for ourselves, too.
Correct.
So what the fuck Target?
They take away money from the mom and pop.
Target got insurance.
They got tons of it. They cool. This is why they not gonna run you down when you steal shit.
Bruh. Before we... I wanna keep going, but I need... Something just popped in my head. I need to play this song. For all my niggas down south that taught me about the Second Amendment. If you are black and in a state that allows you to exercise that Second Amendment, listen to this fucking song. Y'all ready to die for this black shit? I need to know, y'all. Are you ready to die for being black? I know that shit sound morbid, but us as a culture, we gotta realize that as a race, as a nationality, whatever the fuck you wanna call it, we gotta figure this out. Are you willing to die to protect your children? To protect your sisters, your mothers, your aunts, your girls?
And this goes for them so-called motherfucking allies, too. Y'all niggas willing to die? Is y'all? Y'all want to be out here when the cameras are popping, but on some real shit, y'all ready to take some bullets? Don't be out here because it's cute. Don't be out here because it looks nice and something you can post on your motherfucking social media.
And because y'all could get away with rioting.
Exactly. You can get away with being the fucking cop's face. You can get away with breaking up shit and nothing happening to y'all. Nah, don't join the fight if you ain't ready to die too. I don't even like to be on this vibration right now. You know what I'm saying? I like to keep it real tame, but nah, it's necessary. I needed to purge. I had a lot of shit bottled up in me. I needed this purge. Being in a perpetual state of anger is just not healthy, though. But it's necessary. If I have to be in this space and place just so I know my fucking nephews can live, I'ma fucking do it. Period. If you ain't got no felonies, get your gun license. The good life becomes trifling. Niggas ain't shooting fair ones, they gun fighting. Go get your gun license. Don't be an outlaw like me. License to kill. A lot of y'all rappers need to enlighten your skills. Everything that I say on the mic is for real. A license to kill, deeper than the knife and the steel. The cop, the doctor, the judge, license to kill. Some of your enemies who you fighting in the field. Did they paperwork, they got a license to kill. Do your fucking paperwork. Thank you, State of Virginia. Just got the OOP. Don't you stand on my block. Got enough shots for your stupid. Doing the rock like an old school dance. We got the right to bear arms. So under my red monkey jeans, I went cross.
beat the system at their own game. Yeah, y'all. Dropping street knowledge, I'm trying to prepare y'all.
Fire in my heart, guns in the car, cash on the car. And I know hip hop police is listening to this shit. When I make it big, y'all gonna come back and hear this. Don't think y'all gonna Mike Jackson me. Yo, that was P.hucY. Shout out to Brownsville, Bed-Stuy, East New York, P.hucY, Legend. Those three communities, that's License to Kill. Shout out to E-Block if y'all niggas is hearing this. Miss Aay Jay, I'm too much, my head is in a million and one spots. I can't be clear, like, anymore on what I'm feeling. So, like, I'm putting my mic down until the next song. And after that, we're going to wrap it up. This is the Purge episode, y'all. So, when y'all hear this, please leave y'all comments, your thoughts, your feelings, and, comment and let us know. I'll share them with Aay Jay. And we figure this shit out together as a community, y'all.
Absolutely.
Wait, you stopped recording? Oh, you ain't stopped recording yet?
Nah.
Good. Don't stop recording yet.
I think that was a beautiful way to end it. Like, yeah, that anything was. Else I was gonna say was just gonna incite more anger. So.
Right. So since I said doing this as a community, y'all, we're gonna end this up with a song. I know this is a shorter episode, y'all. This is the two pack with Miss Aay Jay. But we're gonna end this with this song right here.
For today's Connection Corner, I leave you with a post that I found on Instagram. I don't know who it's written by, but the words are extremely profound. It reads, "You want to know why black people are angry? We can't be handcuffed and put in a police car unless we are dead. George Floyd. We can't go bird watching in Central Park. Christian Cooper. We can't go jogging, Ahmaud Arbery. We can't relax in the comfort of our homes, Boteem Sean and Atiana Jefferson. We can't ask for help after being in a car crash, Jonathan Ferrell, Renisha McBride. We can't have a cell phone, Stephon Clark. We can't leave a party to get to safety, Jordan Edwards. We can't play loud music, Jordan Davis. We can't sell CDs, Alton Sterling. We can't sleep, Ayanna Jones. We can't walk from the corner store, Mike Brown. We can't play cops and robbers, Tamir Rice. We can't go to church, Charleston 9. We can't walk home with Skittles, Trayvon Martin. We can't hold a hairbrush while leaving our bachelor party, Sean Bell. We can't party on New Year's, Oscar Grant. We can't get a normal traffic ticket, Sandra Bland. We can't lawfully carry a weapon, Philando Castile. We can't break down on a public road with car problems, Corey Jones. We can't shop at Walmart, John Crawford. We can't have a disabled vehicle, Terrence Crutcher. We can't read a book in our own car, Keith Scott. We can't be a 10-year-old walking with our grandfather, Clifford Glover. We can't decorate for a party, Claude Reese. We can't ask a cop a question, Randy Evans. We can't cash our check in peace, Yvonne Smallwood. We can't take out our wallet, Amadou Diallo. We can't run, Walter Scott. We can't breathe, Eric Garner. We can't live, Freddie Gray. We're tired. Tired of making hashtags. Tired of trying to convince you that our black lives matter too. Tired of dying. Tired. 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 Thank you for joining us.